PhD in biochemistry and molecular biology, working in Don Bryant's lab on cyanobacteria.
Green sulfur bacteria.
Green sulfur bacteria, sorry. Way cooler than cyanobacteria. And she did a postdoc at MIT with Ed DeLong for how many years?
Four?
Almost four. And now she's finishing up her fifth year as an assistant professor in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at University of Delaware. And you might wonder why anybody that works in civil and environmental engineering is doing microbiology. She's going to tell us that today.
Thanks for the invitation. It's really great to be here finally. I tried to come last semester and failed because it was raining. I think it was raining in Atlanta, and therefore I could not get from Philly to here. So it's great to finally be here. Can you hear me at the back? Okay. Sometimes I mumble it. I'm not going to talk about any of my engineering projects during this seminar. I do have some collaborations with both environmental engineers and civil engineers looking at bacteria in stormwater filter systems in and on top of concrete. And we're sort of moving in the direction of thinking about bacteria in different types of soil. But what I'm going to talk about today is bacteria that use light, specifically in the Chesapeake Bay. And although this project started out focusing on bacterial rhodopsins and how they work and where we find them, it really has morphed into a project looking at how bacteria use light. And the reason that this is really important right now is the following. I made this graph myself. I'm really proud of it. This is how many photons reach the Earth every second. This is 3.6 teramoles of photons every second reaching the Earth. And this is how many of those photons are used in photosynthesis. So light is a really unlimited resource, at least in surface environments, right? If you look at the satellite picture of the Earth, you can see, well, it's hard to see in here. This is all, but it's all green, right? All of this land mass is green. There's chlorophyll there. All of these green spots in the coastal areas, this is chlorophyll. All this green stuff, chlorophyll. There's photosynthesis in all of these places. The only places where chlorophyll A is not detectable is in these purple areas. They're kind of hard to see here in the middle of the oceans. And even so, even with the Earth blanketed with chlorophyll, they only use this much of the available light. So how else is light used? Is it used in ways that don't involve chlorophyll? And if it is, what does that do for the cell? So these are the questions that we've been really focusing on for the last couple of years. Light is a pretty much unlimited resource, but chlorophyll A captures very little of it. So how else is it used and who uses it? Phototrophy with chlorophyll, as you probably all know, happens, photosynthesis specifically, happens in plants, in cyanobacteria, and also in bacteria chlorophyll A utilizing organisms, right? And all of these chlorophyll-type photosystems have in common a couple of things. They're very large supermolecular complexes that involve 20 to 30 different proteins. They involve multiple kinds of cofactors, right? There's chlorophyll, there are pheophytins, there are carotenoids, there are quinones, there are iron sulfur clusters, and all of those things are arranged in very specific organization in these huge photosystems, right? And no matter what kind of chlorophyll you have these very specific carefully structured pigment protein complexes. So this represents a major sink of energy and resources for cells that do photosynthesis. But there are simpler ways to capture light energy, right? So one of the ways that's really common in a lot of different types of systems is rhodopsin. So this is actually what we have in the eye that senses light. Microbes have them too. And it's a very simple pigment protein complex. It's a single protein that has seven transmembrane domains, you can see them here, and one cofactor that's in the middle of the channel. This is retinol. And this retinol is a small rigid cofactor that absorbs a photon. When it absorbs a photon, it undergoes a cis-trans isomerization, and that bend in the molecule induces a conformational change in the protein. Then, in the eye, that conformational change sends a message to the brain that says, we saw light. There are bacteria that also use rhodopsins to sense light. So then it initiates a signaling cascade to tell the cell, we saw light, and change gene expression. But most of the microbial rhodopsins actually pump ions in response to light. So the conformational change that's induced by absorption of a photon transfers an ion across the membrane. Often that ion is a proton. It gets really hard to have proton, photon, and protein in the same sentence, so I may get them mixed up. It's not because I don't know. Often that ion is a proton, so it contributes to the proton motive force that cells then utilize to synthesize ATP. It can also be other ions, so there are specific chloride or sodium pumps that utilize light to transport those ions. They typically absorb light in the 490 to 590 nanometer range, so blue to green light. And they're found, they were originally found in hypersaline lagoons, but they're also found in the ocean, in estuaries, in freshwater. They're ubiquitous, really, in the environment. People have found them in bacteria on leaf surfaces, for example. They're really widespread, as I said. Anybody who's flown in and out of San Francisco, Barb, did you see these today?
Maybe.
If you've flown in
or
out. If you look out the window, I took this picture with a very, very old cell phone camera years ago. But if you look out the window when you're flying over San Francisco, you often can see these salt evaporator ponds. And they're purple. They're bright purple. And that bright purple color is from halo archaea that make rhodopsins. And they use light to capture energy. So it is really common. And the questions that we wanted to answer related to phototrophy without chlorophyll are, how much do we think there is? So based on the data that we have available to us now, how widespread is this? And then can we develop a method to quantify it directly? So not based just on gene abundances, but based on something that we can see with our eyeballs. And then last, what does it do for the cell? People have been studying microbial rhodopsins for a long time. And we say, well, they pump protons, so they contribute to the proton motive force, and the cells have more ATP, so they should grow faster. Actually, it's very hard to see a phenotype in cells that so it's pretty rare that somebody can measure a phenotype that's related to light. I'll talk about that again later. So, eubacterial rhodopsins in normal bacteria are pretty diverse, genetically speaking, so we know a lot about rhodopsin sequences. We find them in a lot of different environments, and so we can compare those sequences and classify them into different types. So the proteorhodopsin type proton pumps, these are the ones that made Odette Béja famous, are down here in one cluster. There are proton pumps found in flavobacteria that are in the same general group. Most of the ion pumps that don't pump protons fall into one clade here. There are proton pumps over here that are xanthorhodopsin-like. So in this group, actually, the only ones that have been biochemically characterized are this one, Solenobacter, and the one from Gliobacter. And we added this Rhodolino one last year. And then last, there are the photosensory rhodopsins. So these are rhodopsins that don't pump protons or other ions, but they are used instead in light sensing. And a couple of years ago, Odette Béja and someone in his lab did a reanalysis of the Global Ocean Survey metagenomic data set. So you've all seen this data set or heard of it, right? J. Craig Venter III went around the ocean, threw a bucket in the water, whatever he felt like it, and then sequenced it, right, to see what's in the ocean in different places. And what they wanted to know is, what are the relative abundances of rhodopsins and chlorophyll-type photosystems? So how many cells are there that have each type of photosystem in different environments? And what they found, and you can see that this from this graph, is that in the majority of environments, rhodopsins are much, much more common than chlorophyll-type photosystems, right? So we can see algae from space. There are so many of them that we can see them from space. And yet, there are way, way more cells that have rhodopsins. That's what these red lines are. The green lines are things with chlorophyll. And if you look specifically at, most of these are marine samples, but if you look specifically at estuarine samples, which is what's in this yellow box here, we see that the same is true for those estuarine samples. And in fact, the middle bar there is the Chesapeake Bay. And they estimate that in the Chesapeake Bay, around 65% of the cells have rhodopsins. So even in not very exotic environments like Chesapeake, rhodopsins are very common. And it looks, from this graph, like in a lot of illuminated environments, most organisms can use light. Okay, so we can answer our first question just based on this metagenomic survey that someone else did for us, which is how much phototrophy without chlorophyll do we think that there is? And it looks like up to 65% of cells in estuaries, at up to 95% of cells in marine environments. Some of these bars are really high. This is amazing. In marine environments, have rhodopsins. This is a really common phenomenon. So the next thing we want to know is this is, as I said, based on gene abundances, but it doesn't tell us whether those genes are turned on, how important they are, how many of those cells are really using light. Just tells us how many of those cells have the potential to use light. So what we want to know that next is, can we quantify this directly? Can we back up this prediction of 65 to 95% of cells having rhodopsins with something that's more direct? And in order to do this, it's actually kind of a difficult problem, right? To visualize and quantify rhodopsins in an environmental sample. It's challenging because rhodopsin does have intrinsic autofluorescence, the same way that chlorophyll does. But it's very, very low. And there's not as much of a rhodopsin in a cell membrane as there is chlorophyll. So the signal is going to be much lower than it is in a cyanobacterium. So what we need is a system where we know exactly what's going on, so we can turn it on and off and know what we're looking for. And then we need a super sensitive fluorescence detection system. So we need a controllable expression system with the retinol cofactor. This is that rigid cofactor that goes in the middle of the rhodopsin. We need to be able to turn that on and off when we want it. We need to be able to turn rhodopsin on and off when we need it. And then we need this ultra-sensitive fluorescence detection system. So I actually started dreaming about this project when I was a little tiny postdoc in Boston. I said, you know, someday I'm gonna figure out how to do this, and I'm going to need some of these tools. So I had an undergraduate make this construct for me then. And he's an author on this paper that we published last year. So the undergraduate research that you're doing now, if your undergrad's here, you may be contacted out of the blue 5 or 6 years from now to say, is this your right contact information, and can you remind me exactly how you did this? It could still happen. So we have a controllable expression system for producing retinol. This is the cofactor that rhodopsin needs. It's made by breaking beta-carotene, which you're all familiar with from carrots and other vegetables, in half with a cleavage dioxygenase here. So we have a controllable expression system. And there are two things that are important about this. One, we can turn it on whenever we want. And two, we can turn it off. E. coli, this is all heterologous expression in E. coli, and E. coli hates making carotenoids, hates them a lot. If you do carotenoid biosynthesis projects, which is what I did for my PhD work, it sectors like crazy, because these pigments, as you can see, are really hydrophobic, and so they go into the membrane, they disrupt the membrane structure, the colonies look funny. So E. coli that's making lycopene, which is this stuff, makes really big, slimy-looking colonies. If it's making beta-carotene, it makes really tiny colonies that look dry and they stack up on top of each other. They're like towers instead of round colonies. E. coli, it just hates them. So you want to be able to, and it mutates them like crazy. So you want to be able to turn it off when all you want to do is propagate the pathogen. So we can turn this system on and off using the arabinose promoter. And then we cloned a novel rhodopsin, actinorhodopsin, out of an actinobacteria. So this is a gram-positive bacteria. It's really common in freshwater environments. You can't see it too well here, but it's red. And we know from the literature that it makes rhodopsins. We don't know anything else about them. All we know is that it was a new type of rhodopsin, typical of freshwater systems, found in this particular strain. So we cloned that rhodopsin and put it into E. coli, and you can see that when it's overexpressed in E. coli that also makes retinol, that E. coli turns pink. So that's what this tube on the left is. So these are the E. coli that are just making the retinol cofactor. They're kind of yellowish. And when you add the rhodopsin, the cells turn pink. So what that means is that the rhodopsin is folding correctly, it's incorporating the cofactor, and it's being inserted into the membrane. This is great. I was really relieved when I saw that pink color. We can also see the protein in a protein gel. So here's the negative control without the rhodopsin, and here's the rhodopsin. And we did also extract this protein from the gel and sequence it to have the mass spec done to make sure that it really was the right protein. And it is. And then if we look at the absorption spectrum of that rhodopsin, we can see that it makes a really nice peak around 528 nanometers, which is really typical for a green light absorbing rhodopsin. So that was nice. So now we have the first two components of the system that we want, right? Control the cofactor and control the expression of a rhodopsin. And what we need next is a sensitive fluorescence detection system. So for this, we went through the Bioimaging Center at the University of Delaware, which is fantastic. And I worked with Chandran Sabanayagam, who is a physicist who can actually build, he built this microscope. He built it from parts. I'm just so amazed that we have people like that. And total internal fluorescence microscopy has a number of advantages. So what happens is the light is focused through a back focal plane here below the objective. And when it hits the cover slip of the glass, most of the light is reflected back. And only a little bit of it goes up through the sample to excite whatever's right here. Because only a little bit of it goes through the glass, it only excites molecules that are very, very close to the glass sample interface, which means that the background is really low. And when we have background that's that low, we can't actually visualize things that have low fluorescent yield. Plus, we have then had a good detector. So this is the system that we used to develop this method for analyzing rhodopsins in macrocycles. Okay, so the first thing we wanted to do was make sure that we could tell the difference between carotenoid pigments and rhodopsins, because they do absorb in the same range of wavelengths, right? Carotenoids typically absorb between 450 and 520 nanometers. And rhodopsins will absorb a little bit redshifted, but there's a lot of overlap between their absorption. So we wanted to make sure that we could tell the difference. So what we did was first illuminate a sample of, these are too small, I can't read them. Let me come back here for a second. Let's see, on the top we have beta-carotene expressing cells here, retinol expressing cells here, lycopene, and then these are just DH10B, so there's no pigment in these cells. So all of these guys are making carotenoids, but not making rhodopsins. And we said we want to make sure that there's some wavelength where we can't see carotenoid fluorescence. So we tried illuminating or exciting with a 488 nanometer laser, and you can see that we do see fluorescence in all of these samples, right? Especially these carotenoid-producing samples. Carotenoids do absorb at 488 nanometers. Yes. But they don't absorb, let me go back, at 561. So we don't see fluorescence. You see a little bit of background, but not as strong as what you see in these ones if we excite at 561 nanometers, which is what you would expect, right? If you look at the absorption spectra for beta-carotene, for example, you see that there's really no absorption at 561 nanometers. And the same for lycopene, which is redshifted. But there's still no absorbance there. So we can tell the difference between a carotenoid fluorescence and rhodopsin fluorescence by exciting with different lasers. The second question we wanted to know is, can we see rhodopsins? So here we have cells expressing both the retinol and the rhodopsin, and here just the rhodopsin, so no cofactor. So this one should not show up any fluorescence. And what we see, we still see fluorescence when we excite at this 488 nanometer laser. But when we excite with a 561 nanometer laser, what we see is strong fluorescence from the cells that are producing the rhodopsin and the cofactor, but not when it's the rhodopsin with no cofactor. So here's the absorption spectrum of the actinorhodopsin, and you can see that you would expect to see fluorescence in both of these cases because it does absorb at both of those wavelengths. Does that make sense? But in the absence of the cofactor, it doesn't absorb, or it can absorb, but it doesn't fluoresce. So you may wonder, we see this with our eyeballs, but can we quantify this a little bit better? Yes, we can. So we've measured actual fluorescence from all of these different samples. And what's important is this stuff here in the yellow box, right? So if the cells are only making beta-carotene or only making retinol, then we see low fluorescence. If they're making rhodopsin with the retinol, then we see much higher fluorescence when excited with this 561 nanometer laser. Okay, so this is the proof of principle stuff, right? But really what we want to be able to do is say, we can see this in a field sample, and we can apply it in mixed samples. So first, before that, it's not great in here, but we can also see E. coli, because E. coli cells are fairly large, that the rhodopsin is localized to the membrane. So you can see that an edge around the cells that's brighter. If you take if you measure fluorescence across one of these cells, you'll see that it goes up where the membrane is, goes down a little bit for the cytoplasm and up again. So we can show using TURF microscopy not just that there's rhodopsin there, but that it's localized to the membrane. Okay, so what we wanted to be able to do is distinguish between two populations in a mixed sample. First, we tried it just with two populations of E. coli, some that make beta-carotene and some that are making rhodopsin. So we mixed those cultures together, excited first with the 488 nanometer laser, then with the 561, and then merged. And you can clearly see in this merged image that there are two different populations of cells. So again, proof of principle. And And then we wanted to make sure, because this is a controllable system, right? So we can turn expression up as high as we want. There's a ton of protein in there. But natural isolates might make rhodopsins at lower levels. So before we went to a natural sample, we tried with a natural isolate. This is a Dachdonia species that's been shown to make rhodopsins in previous experiments. We got the cells from Endolong, and we show the same, that they both make both carotenoids and rhodopsins, and we can detect it using this method. So even natural levels of expression are high enough to be detected using drug microscopy. Okay, so then, after all that, we said, we're going to try this in the field. So we went, let's see, Newark, Delaware is right around here. So we went to the Delaware River, which is right here. If you just drive straight east from Newark till you get to water, that's where you end up. And we collected a bucket of water, looks like that. This was actually my total contribution to this set of experiments. I helped Jessica collect the water, and I took pictures of it. This is pretty dirty water. You see New Jersey over here. I was thinking of New Jersey. And she extracted DNA. We did two things with this water. We wanted to make sure that there were rhodopsins to be detected in the water, right? So first she PCR amplified rhodopsins from the water sample and showed that they are, and sequenced the fragments. And she showed that they're related to marine proteorhodopsins. So you can see this here, Pelagibacter ubique is a very common marine organism that has some rhodopsins. And most of the things that we got out of the Delaware River are related to that. So we knew there was going to be something to see, or there should be, if our method would work. And so then she did analyze those environmental samples. So first we stained with DAPI. We wanted to make sure that everything we were looking at really was a cell. And DAPI is a DNA stain. So first we showed that there are cells. They have DNA. We looked at the carotenoid fluorescence. This is actually not that important, but we didn't see any. It was really too low. And we do see that several of the cells in the sample have rhodopsins. There's one thing that we can't control for in these samples, and that is phycobilary proteins. So cyanobacteria mostly absorb light with chlorophyll A, right? But they also have accessory light harvesting systems, which I only know about because I did my PhD work with Don Bryant, and it didn't work on cyanobacteria, but Don's PhD work was on phycobilary proteins in cyanobacteria, so of course we had to know about it. And phycobilary proteins in cyanobacteria absorb in the same range of wavelengths that rhodopsin does, and they fluoresce the same way. So with our system, we cannot tell the difference between a rhodopsin and a phycobilary protein. But we can tell the difference between something with rhodopsin and something with chlorophyll. So what we're doing for now is saying anything that has chlorophyll, we're going to assume does not have a rhodopsin. What that means is that we're going to miss any rhodopsins that are in cyanobacteria, and we know that there are some. So we're definitely going to miss some things with this analysis. But we're okay with it, because there's a lot of things that we're not missing that we couldn't previously measure. So we said anything that has chlorophyll A, which would absorb at 641 nanometers, we're going to disregard. So if we disregard those things, I thought I had a circle. If we disregard the things that have chlorophyll A, which is these two cells, then what we're left with is that two of the four cells that show up in this field of view have rhodopsin. So this works in mixed field samples. It actually works pretty nicely. So, let's see. What we can conclude from this series of experiments that was really just proof of principle experiments is the following. One, it can differentiate between cells that are producing carotenoids, which have a similar absorption spectrum, and rhodopsins. It can show that the rhodopsins are localized to the membrane. You can see it a little better in this picture than you could in the previous picture. And it can be used on mixed environmental samples. Okay, we don't care too much about the Delaware River, but there are some really interesting gradients, environmental gradients, both in the Delaware Bay and in the Chesapeake Bay. So my former postdoc, Jessica Keffer, jumped on a cruise with Barb last spring and went from the top of the Chesapeake, where the water is fresh, this is where the Susquehanna drains into the Chesapeake Bay, down the Chesapeake towards the ocean. So along this cruise track, there's a salinity gradient. Salinity is increasing from basically fresh up here to marine salinities down here. So we collected water for DNA, both for DNA analysis and for turf microscopy. So we fixed it with paraformaldehyde. I don't have any slides showing that the fixation doesn't affect the fluorescence, but we did all those experiments with E. coli before we did the field experiments. So we're reasonably certain that fixation and storage in the did pre-filter through 1 millimeter filters, no, 1 micron filters, and collect on 0.2 microns. So we're looking only at a very specific size fraction in these samples. And we collected samples daily at 11 in the morning and 11 at night. And this was because we wanted to see not just is there a difference in rhodopsin abundance along this salinity gradient, but also is there a difference in rhodopsin abundance between day and night. So this is a light responsive protein, and there could be differences in expression with and without sunlight. We also collected depth profiles along at 5 sites along this gradient. And we do have the data, but I don't think I have a slide about it here. So we do see rhodopsins in the Chesapeake. This is just the equivalent of the figure I showed you from the Delaware River, where you see we first DAPI stained all the cells to make sure that what we were looking at was a cell that has DNA in it. We get rid of anything that has chlorophyll A fluorescence, and we, based on those two things, we identify the cells that have rhodopsin fluorescence. So my student, Kelsey Miller, very painfully worked through. We had 5 day and 5 night samples, and we collected samples in triplicate. And for each triplicate sample, she prepared 3 slides, and for each slide, she analyzed between 20 and 30 fields of view. So this is a lot of time in a very dark room that she did. But based on her heroic efforts, what we see is really nice. We see this really beautiful correlation between salinity and rhodopsin abundance. And we see a couple of really interesting trends here. One is that there are consistently about twice as many cells with rhodopsin, which is, you know, what you would expect, although I'm a little bit curious as to what those rhodopsins are doing at night. We also see that, as I said, that they increase really nicely with salinity, although there's this one funny point in the middle of the bay where there were relatively few rhodopsins in the daytime sample. We also notice that there are rhodopsins present both in the freshwater samples and in the marine lake samples. So they do correlate with salinity, but it doesn't mean that there are none in the freshwater. Freshwater rhodopsins were only relatively recently identified, and we weren't really sure how common they were. So it's nice to see them in the Chesapeake. What's next? So Kelsey is now working on qPCR to see if we can get a gene-based estimate to compare to the microscopic data. Right? We think that up to 65% of the cells in the Chesapeake have rhodopsins. Right? This is about 60, a little over 60%. But can we get a more traditional method, use a more traditional method, to estimate abundance so that we can compare our numbers with those? So that's what she's working on right now. Okay, so previously we said, based on metagenomic data, specifically in the Chesapeake, we think about 65% of the cells should have rhodopsins. Based on the turf microscopy, we estimate that about 65% of the cells in the Chesapeake have rhodopsins. This is a really nice agreement of experimental data with metagenomic data. It shocked me deeply. But we still have this outstanding question, right? I come from a lab where we did growth curves and physiology, and we just want to know how things work, right, all the time. So the question that we didn't yet know the answer to is, what do these rhodopsins do for the cell? So we started working on this question using actinorhodopsin from freshwater actinobacteria to answer this question. And it showed us some very unexpected things. So I showed you this figure before to say that we know a lot about the sequences of microbial rhodopsins. And what we're interested in specifically is these rhodopsins from freshwater, very small actinobacteria. So these guys are at most 0.2 microns long. But they do seem to be fairly common in freshwater environments. The other thing that we know a lot about in rhodopsins is how they work, like biochemically, what they do. We know exactly what happens when the retinol absorbs a photon. We know exactly which bond isomerizes, right? We know exactly when that protein's conformational change happens, which amino acids are moved, and how their pKa's change in order to push an ion across the membrane. We know so much about these things and how they work biochemically. We don't know anything about them physiologically, why they're important to the cell. So based on the sequence of the actinorhodopsin, we predict that it's a proton hop. If I remember correctly, which I may not because Jessica made this slide, these red amino acids are involved in proton pumping. The green one is involved in tuning the absorption spectrum, so changes in that amino acid, just one amino acid, can change the wavelength of light that it absorbs at. But this had not been biochemically confirmed. So as part of the experiments for the previous Turk microscopy stuff, we had cloned that rhodopsin and started to analyze it. I showed you this before. We showed that the protein is the protein. We showed that it has an absorption spectrum that with a maximum absorption at 500 nanometers. And since we had this in E. coli, we could measure proton pumping in E. coli, right? So if E. coli is pumping protons in the light, then what happens is you turn the light on, it pumps protons out, and the pH should go down, right? And so, and this should be straightforward to measure. So that's exactly what we did. Turn the light on, pH goes down. Turn the light off, pH goes back up, or it starts to drift. Turn the light on, pH goes down. Works really nicely. Okay, so actinorhodopsin is a proton pump. That's excellent. We can also add a proton ionophore, and that blocks this activity, and it's blocked as you would expect. So proton pumping in E. coli requires both the light and the rhodopsin with its retinol cofactor. But when we measured proton pumping in the natural host, right, so Rhodolinolace E. coli is this gram-positive organism out of which we cloned the actinorhodopsin, right? We said, okay, great. Actinorhodopsin is a proton pump. Let's measure proton pumping in the host. Nothing happens. Nothing. No matter how many cells we concentrate into one place. At first we thought, well, maybe we just don't have enough cells in our assay, right? Concentrate half a liter or a liter of cells into 1 mL. Doesn't matter. Never see proton pumping. I'm going to tell you about a lot of failure for the next 15 minutes or so. Just get ready for that. There's a happy ending. So one of the first experiments we did, even before we tried any of the proton pumping, was does this gram-positive organism grow faster in the light than in the dark? Is this going to be something that's worth following up? So we grew them in the light and in the dark, and look, there's a growth phenotype. It grows faster in the light. I said, great, this rhodopsin does something, and it does something measurable. So this is a really good organism to use as our model. None of the model systems that people work with rhodopsins in grow faster in the light than in the dark. So this is unusual and great, and we're going to be famous. I'm going to get tenure. But we had this tragedy. So then what? Well, maybe it's not expressed. So Jessica extracted RNA from cells grown in the light and in the dark. The negative control's not here. The negative control was negative. So we're sure that this is not amplification from contaminating DNA. And she amplified from the RNA the actinorhodopsin transcript, and it's there. It's there all the time. It's there early in the growth phase, it's there late in the growth phase, it's there in the light, it's there in the dark, it moves around. So this gene is highly expressed. So the problem is not that the gene is not expressed. Okay, so maybe the protein's not translated. So she did a membrane prep, she extracted the protein, and what we see here is that this rhodopsin, and this was the band that we sent out for mass spectrometry, so we're sure that this is really the rhodopsin. It's the most abundant protein in the membrane. There's a ton of protein being synthesized here. So the problem is not that the protein's not being made either. Oh, yeah, that's just the mass spec data. So, but there's no pumping. And I kept making her do these experiments, like maybe it will work this time. Never works. So then I thought, well, maybe the light phenotype was fake. Maybe we just got lucky that one time, or maybe it was warmer in the tubes that were exposed to the light and not the ones that were exposed. So we did this again. We've done this experiment so many times under so many different conditions. We're sure that it's not a difference in temperature. We're sure that it's not a difference in pH. We're sure that it's not a difference in the organic carbon in the medium aging in the light. That was one of the things we thought. Maybe light is breaking down the complex organic carbon and making it easier for those cells that are growing in the light to uptake and consume, right? We tested all of those possibilities. None of them made a difference. The only thing that makes a difference is the light. So then we thought, well, maybe particular wavelengths of light would make a difference. And so we did that. This data is hot off the presses. I did this myself last week. And in the dark, that's the black line here, they grow at this rate. If you grow them in red or green light, so 650 and 525 nanometer light, grows just like the dark. They're blind to those wavelengths of light. The only light that makes a difference is shorter wavelength, blue, or long wavelength UV light, 375 or 425. So this is a real phenotype, and it's based on the response to 375 or 425 nanometer light, or light in that range. Okay, but what about the rhodopsin? Why doesn't it work? So then we checked for the presence of the cofactor. And what we find is that it's just not there. So these are all the pigments that those red cells make, mostly C50 carotenoids. This is what where retinol should run. So this is just a commercial standard of retinol. And there's none of it here. And when we looked in the genome, there were no homologs to the gene that the cleavage dioxygenase that breaks beta carotene in half. That wasn't too surprising. There are other potential ways to break beta carotene in half. So that didn't worry me originally, but now that we couldn't detect the cofactor, maybe that is real. I also had a student make a genomic library and screen it. So we made a genomic library of all the genes in Rotoluna, and we put them into E. coli that was making beta carotene. That E. coli is yellow. We screened for loss of color, so something that would be able to break down that beta carotene. And we didn't find anything in that screen either, nothing. And like I said, we don't find any retinol in the pigment extract. So it looks like the protein is really abundant, and the reason it doesn't work is that the cofactor is not there. Okay. So then we thought, well, maybe there's a different cofactor in there, right? These bugs are unusual. Even their carotenoids are kind of unusual. Maybe they just don't have retinol in there. So we tried to take an absorption spectrum of the rhodopsin. It's hard because these carotenoids are so brightly colored, and the absorption spectra would overlap, right? The rhodopsin should be a peak in here, and that's completely obscured by all of these carotenoids. So we did various purifications, and nothing really worked. Let's see. Then she tried oxidizing the carotenoids with ammonium persulfate. So the rhodopsin retinol complex shouldn't be bleached by ammonium persulfate because the pigment is inside the protein and it should be protected in there. So we did this with E. coli and showed that if you attack the E. coli membranes with ammonium persulfate, you see the peak from the rhodopsin, it goes down a little bit, but it doesn't disappear. It has this fairly strong peak. We do the same thing with the rhodolunolase E. coli membranes, and all the carotenoids go away, which is what we had hoped. But there should be appearance of a peak here. Doesn't happen. There's really nothing there. All this biochemistry was very painful for all of us. And it's just not there. Okay, so we're really sure that this rhodopsin doesn't work in its natural host. But if we feed Rotoluna retinol, that cofactor, it does pump protons. So it would work if the cofactor were present, right? So we see this really active proton pumping in the light if we feed those cells the correct cofactor. And it does disappear when you hit it with the proton ion forward and so on. So it's what you would expect. And if we, I don't know why it's like that. Okay, so if we then bleach the membranes from the retinol-fed organism with ammonium persulfate, you do see appearance of a small peak here. They don't, it's not a lot, but it's some. So that experiment would have worked if there were a cofactor present. So the cofactor is really just not there. It's very hard to prove a negative. That was why we had to do all of this stuff, right? But I will say that the reviews came back with no suggestions. I've never gotten reviews like that. So we did apparently effectively prove a negative. But it was hard. Okay, so what does the actinorhodopsin do for the cell? Nothing. Nothing. How is this possible? They make so much of this protein, and they grow faster in the light, but it doesn't do anything at all because the cofactor is just not there. So what's going on? What are the potential light harvesting systems in this organism? Luckily, rhodolunolase E. coli has a genome sequence. Somebody sequenced it a few years ago. So I spent a couple of days on my couch, not talking to anybody, and looking for ways that Rotoluna could absorb light in the genome. And there are three. One is the rhodopsin. It's not that. One is the carotenoids. So these pigments that make the cells red. Carotenoids are not typically, they don't typically contribute to a difference in growth rate. But it's not outside the realm of possibility. Fortuitously, we isolated a white mutant a couple of years ago, so we can't do genetics in this strain. But a white colony appeared on a plate one time. And once we were sure that it was not a contaminant, we did a few tricks to make sure that that was not a contaminant, we said, okay, well maybe it really is a white mutant. And if it's a white mutant, that means that there's a mutation in one of two genes early in the carotenoid biosynthetic pathway. So I had a student sequence those two genes from the white mutant, and we showed that there's a frameshift mutation in one. This is the very first step in carotenoid biosynthesis. If there's a mutation in that gene, you won't make any colored compounds at all. So that's where we had a mutation. So, awesome. Now we have a tool, and we can answer this question. Are the carotenoids involved in this light response? still grows faster in the light than in the dark without those carotenoids. So that's not it. So what's left? As far as I can tell, in the genome, there's only one other way for Rotoluna to absorb light. So we're getting now into the speculative, hand-waving part of my talk. There are two cryptochromes and one DNA photolyase in the genome. And this is one large protein superfamily. So they all have a flavin binding domain and a DNA binding domain. So they're similar structurally to some degree. The DNA photolyase, as far as we can tell, is a normal DNA photolyase. I do have an undergraduate working on that to confirm that it's a normal photolyase. So far it seems to be. But cryptochromes are widespread in all domains of life. They have two bound flavins. So this is how they absorb light, right? Flavins will absorb blue light. And that makes sense, because it's the blue light that makes the difference in the growth. There is a CLIB type. These have been characterized in Rotobacter, which is a photosynthetic organism, that also has a C-terminal iron-sulfur cluster. For those of you who are biochemists, iron-sulfur clusters are very exciting. In animals, plants, and fungi, these guys regulate circadian rhythms. So they're known to be involved in responses to light. And they don't capture light energy and then convert it to chemical energy the way that rhodopsins do. What they do is they capture light energy and convert it to information that tells the cell or the organism what to do in response to light. And in Rotobacter, they do contribute to the regulation of photosynthesis. So they're not the only regulator of photosynthesis, but they're one of the things that contributes. So we did, my lab had to shut down for 6 or 7 weeks last winter because they were replacing the electrical system in the building. The building is so old that the electrical system had to be completely replaced. So my lab had to shut down. And so I had my postdoc send off some RNA to be sequenced so that she could have something to do for those 6 weeks while the lab was closed. And here's what she found. We grew Rotoluna in the light and in the dark. We did this with 4 biological replicates. So we're sure that this data is fairly robust. And so let's see. This is the ratio of expression in the light over expression in the dark. So things on this side of the plot are transcribed more in the light. Things over here are transcribed more in the dark. And what we see in the light is strong upregulation of sugar transporters and sugar metabolism. So this could explain the growth phenotype, right? They're taking in more sugars and they're metabolizing them. And that helps the cells to grow faster. In the dark, what we see is upregulation of things involved in oxidative stress and recovery from stress conditions. This is the DNA photolyase that I talked about. So it looks like the dark time is for them a time to recover from stresses and repair things, right? Similar to the way that sleep is for us. In the light, what we see is upregulation of the actinorhodopsin. So that's kind of nice. This should be light responsive, even if it doesn't work. And there it is. And one of the cryptochromes. The other cryptochrome is the single most upregulated thing in the dark. The single most. So this is suggesting that we're kind of on the right track with these light-sensing proteins and how they contribute to a change in growth efficiency. But that's where we are right now. So we're continuing to analyze this transcriptome. Right after she made this plot, Jessica left for DuPont, Trader. So I have now a student who's working on analyzing that data. We did the same data, the same analysis, growth in the light and in the dark, in a related organism that doesn't have a rhodopsin, but does have the same growth phenotype. So it grows faster in the light than in the dark, even though it doesn't have a rhodopsin. So we have the same transcriptome analysis for that one, but we had to sequence its genome first because we didn't have it. I also want to co-cultivate these guys in the presence of algae for 2 reasons. One, a lot of algae do make retinol, and so that's a potential source of the retinol for the rhodopsin. And the other is that I think what's going on here is that the light is a signal to the actinobacteria that primary producers are about to start pumping out tons of organic carbon, and right now is a good time to take it up, right? And so there are 2 potential points of contact between these heterotrophs, they're strictly heterotrophs, and primary producers in natural systems. So I want to co-cultivate them in the presence of algae or cyanobacteria from similar environments to see if there's an improvement in growth efficiency and growth rate of either of those strains. I have cloned the 2 cryptochromes, and I'm working on overexpressing them, you know, in all my free time, and then characterizing their activity with respect to the DNA binding or DNA repair, and so forth. Okay, so I can make a lot of conclusions, and then I have a lot of questions that we make, right? Based on the first things that I talked about, we can say that TERF microscopy allows us to directly visualize rhodopsin-producing cells in natural samples. And in the saltier part of the Chesapeake, most cells appear to be using light. And let me emphasize that what we're looking at in these images is not just cells that could be using light. It's cells that are making a protein that does absorb light. We wouldn't see it if it weren't functional. So these are cells that are making functional rhodopsin. 65% of those cells are using light. And that the rhodopsin abundance is correlated both with daytime and with salinity. And what we're working on now is seeing if we can get some qPCR numbers to compare the microscopy numbers to. Second, based on the rhodopsin biochemistry, I can say that actinorhodopsin is a light-stimulated proton pump in E. coli, right? When it's overexpressed in E. coli, that's what it does. It pumps protons like crazy and it's great. Or in retinol-fed rhodolinolase E. coli, but we have to supply the cofactor to it. And that the gene encoding the actinorhodopsin is constitutively expressed, but in pure culture, it doesn't make a functional ion pump, right? So next, what we really want to do, as I said, is co-culture with something that makes retinol that could feed it. Okay, so where are we going next? This is a really active project in my lab. I have a couple of students working on different aspects. So we're looking at the genome sequence of this related strain MO1, which doesn't have a rhodopsin but does have the same growth rate phenotype. We're looking at transcriptome data. We are starting the co-cultivations as soon as my friend Wade sends me cyanobacteria. And we're looking at how else actinobacteria use light. So we're looking at the DNA photolyse and also at the carotenoid biosynthetic pathways. And we're also starting to think about how else those actinobacteria might be using the rhodopsin, right? Are they using it to transport something? It's produced so much that it's hard for me to believe that it does nothing, right? So does it transport something else not in response to light? Does it sense light under particular conditions? Does it just make big rafts in the membrane that stabilize those membranes? We don't know. So we're thinking about ways to start to address those kinds of questions. Okay, and with that, I think I'll just stop talking. I do need to thank Jessica Kepler, who's the postdoc who did most of the work that I talked about, and Kelsey Miller, who's the heroic graduate student who did all the microscopy. Of course, Chandran, who built the instrument, was instrumental in doing this. And let's see, Elena, Monica, and Priscilla, and Stephen are students who have contributed in different ways. Barb Campbell, of course, for the field samples, and Tom Hinson at UD, who built the little LED light systems that let me do the growth rate analysis under different light conditions. And with that, I will stop and take any questions you have. Thanks. Like I said, the mutation that we have in the carotenoid biosynthetic pathway was fortuitous. We just happened to see it because it was a visible phenotype. So yeah, it would be great to have a genetic system in Rhodoluna that we could use for making a knockout. But we can't do it right now. I hesitate to put a graduate student on that kind of project, developing a genetic system, because I've been on that kind of project and it's terrible. And I'm pre-tenure, right? So I just don't have the time to have a student spend any time at all on something that could not work at all. So yes, of course I thought about it. It would be great, but we can't do it. But we can kind of come close. So the related actinobacterium MO1 that I mentioned that has the same phenotype, we include in these analyses because it doesn't have a rhodopsin. So we can't make a knockout, but we can look at a related strain that's missing that gene. And what we see is the same phenotype. It grows in the dark and in green light and red light the same way. And in blue light or long wavelength, UV, it grows faster. So the loss of the rhodopsin doesn't destroy the cell. The other thing that we have done, since I went past this, was we exposed these cells to bile salts to see if maybe there was a difference in membrane stability. So again, we can't do it with a knockout, but we can compare the strains with rhodopsin to the strains without. And we have a second strain that has a rhodopsin. So what we show here is percent survival of these three different strains after exposure to bile salts, which intercalates in between the leaflets of the membrane. And what we see is that the two strains that have rhodopsins survive less than the one that doesn't have a rhodopsin. But I hesitate, so I have this plot in case people ask, which you didn't, but I would hesitate to read too much into this. One, it was a physics undergraduate who did a summer project, so I'm not totally sure how careful she was about this experiment. One. Two, these things, they really hate growing on plates. Plating efficiency is not really all that good. So these differences that you see could just be differences in plating efficiency between those three strains. But we are thinking about ways to compare the strains that do and don't have rhodopsins to get at this question of what happens if the rhodopsin's not there. But we can't make a mutation.
Any other questions?